This video is supported by Brilliant.org. Alright, let's get this out of the way right off the bat. Does hypnosis work? Well, the answer depends on your expectations. If you expect hypnosis to fix all of your problems, then no, it's probably not going to work. But if you expect it to reduce your stress or play a small part in a holistic health program, then, you know, there's something to talk about there. Hypnotism has a long, interesting history, and it's shed some really interesting lights on the brain's function and how it works, but it's also had its share of controversy. Dr. James Braid is often called the father of hypnosis, which is ironic because back in the day, he was one of its biggest skeptics. Because in the early 1800s, hypnotism was really just more of a party trick, you know, like something more for entertainment. Yeah, you know those hypnotist shows where they get people on stage and get them to quack like ducks and that kind of thing? Yeah, that stuff goes way back. On November 13, 1841, Braid attended a performance of the French hypnotist Charles Lafontaine, and he actually left infuriated. He was convinced the whole thing was a hoax. So about a week later, he went to another one of Lafontaine's performances, and he actually stormed the stage, determined to, you know, show that he was a charlatan. But to everybody's surprise, mostly Braid's, he found that the people up on stage couldn't open their eyes. And this went against everything he knew about involuntary response. So like any good scientist, he started researching it, started studying it, and eventually started using it to treat his patients. Now, of course, he wanted to be taken seriously. He didn't want people to compare what he was doing to that kind of stage trick stuff that Lafontaine was doing, so he coined a new term, hypnosis. Hypnos being the Greek god of sleep who lives in a cave beside a field of poppies next to his brother, Death. Sleep tight, kids. So Dr. Braid coined the term hypnosis, but what Lafontaine did and the other performers did actually went by a different name back then, mesmerism. This was named after Dr. Franz Anton Mesmer 60 years before that. Mesmer was a doctor in Vienna, Austria, and he had developed some interesting ideas about the human body. Most of these ideas started in 1774. He was treating a patient, her name was Franziska Oosterlin, and he wasn't getting anywhere with her, she wasn't getting any better, so he sought out the help of a Jesuit priest and an astronomer whose name was Maximilian Hell. I swear I'm not making this up. There was a Jesuit priest whose last name was Hell, and he was a court astronomer for Austria and Hungary. There's a crater on the moon named after the guy. A crater named Hell. So if someone tells you to go to hell, they're probably just saying to go to the moon. Which, if you don't have a spacesuit, would be pretty hellish. By the way, how bad do things have to get if you're a doctor and you have to consult an astronomer to treat your patient? I don't know what to tell you. We've tried everything. Anti-inflammatories, antibiotics, immunotherapy, chemotherapy. I think we need to talk to Neil deGrasse Tyson. Anyway, Father Hell was really into magnets, so he suggested that Mesmer use magnets on this patient, and somehow she actually got better. Magnets. How do they work? From this, Mesmer concluded that the human body has a natural animal magnetism, his actual words, and beyond that, he concluded that he had the ability to actually manipulate people's magnetic fields. We don't, and he didn't. But he convinced a lot of famous people that he did. People like Mozart and Marie Antoinette, whose husband, Louis XVI, was actually skeptical of Mesmer, so he commissioned a Royal Academy of Sciences investigation into him. A couple notable members of the commission were actually Benjamin Franklin, who was the American ambassador to France at the time, and Joseph Guillotin, whose device would later cut off the king's head and his own. In the end, the committee decided that there really wasn't anything to Mesmer's claims, that it was all just the power of suggestion and self-delusion, especially in the case of Miss Oosterlin, they believed that her symptoms were all made up in her head to begin with. And with that, Mesmer's techniques fell out of the realm of medicine and into the realm of entertainment. For 67 years anyway, until James Braid brought it back. His lifelong study of hypnotherapy laid the groundwork for the entire practice and established that you could change a person's psychological state and then change it back. Later innovators in the field included Joseph Jastrow and Clark Hull, both of the University of Wisconsin, who explored the medical uses of hypnosis. Ernest and Josephine Hilgard of the Laboratory of Hypnosis at Stanford were also active about this time. And finally, I have to mention Milton Erickson, who was partially paralyzed by polio at age 17, but was able to retrain his mind to recover some function in his limbs. Later, he would go on to apply these same techniques to hypnotherapy, and one of his contributions was he figured out how to put someone in a hypnotic state simply by breaking a handshake with them in a weird way. Simply by shocking people out of a social norm, he was able to change their psychological state, and this is a technique that's still used today. Now, you might have noticed I just used the word trance. But is that really what it is? Even James Braid realized that hypnosis had very little to do with sleep, even though he did name it after the Greek god of sleep. It's really more of a hyper-focused state, where the patient is able to mentally block out any other distractions and focus only on the hypnotherapist's voice. And this is why you often see them using a swinging watch, or in Braid's case, he would use a flickering candle, or anything that people can focus on and block out all the distractions around them. Erickson's method was actually called indirect hypnosis, which was basically saying or doing a thing that sort of snapped the patient out of their world and into the world of the hypnotist's words. Brain scans actually back up the theory that it's more of a hyper-focused state. Back in the 1940s, they began doing EEG tests on patients in a hypnotic state, and what they thought they would see is a spike in alpha brain waves, which are associated with both resting and alertness. But the results were inconsistent. Also inconsistent were high-frequency gamma rays, which were thought to be important in conscious perception. The one type of brain wave that does seem to react consistently to hypnosis is theta waves. Theta actually describes a whole wave of frequencies. On the low end, it's more of a calm and serene state, whereas on the higher end, it's more complex things like solving a math problem. This might explain why people in a hypnotic state are able to conjure up very vivid and detailed descriptions of places that they've never been to, assuming they've been prompted well by the hypnotist. So in a sense, hypnotism is less like daydreaming and more like being really wrapped up in music or a movie. Like if you're watching Jaws and say you jump when the shark leaps out of the water, that's not you daydreaming. That's you being hyper-focused and wrapped up in the movie. Everything else going around you has now faded away. Now, according to Erickson and others, it's when we're in this hyper-focused state that the curtain of the conscious mind is opened up. And a hypnotherapist can use this opportunity to access the subconscious mind. The subconscious mind, of course, is that thing that's running in the background, running these little invisible scripts that actually makes decisions for us subconsciously before our conscious mind is even aware of it. It's usually what screws us up. But in hypnotherapy, you can actually access this part of the mind and program it to be a force for good. Psychiatrist Robert London described a case where he used hypnosis as a therapeutic tool for a patient who had PTSD after spending hours stuck in an elevator. This patient suffered flashbacks of the trauma and would become agitated and depressed and tried several different forms of therapy before he finally came to Dr. London and tried hypnotherapy. So while under hypnosis, he was able to actually sort of project these negative and traumatic images on a screen in front of him, in his mind's eye, of course. So instead of being trapped in that scene, he was able to create a little bit of distance from it and see it from an observational standpoint. And at the same time, in his mind, he would conjure up that he himself was sitting in a very serene and calm and peaceful environment. And this actually worked. By being able to create a distance between himself and those traumatic experiences and putting himself in a nice, calm environment, he was able to kind of get through this PTSD and put it all behind him. Now, another advantage of hypnosis is it makes patients more susceptible to suggestion. Hypnotism can be used to implant suggestions of quitting smoking or eating better or simply just waking up and feeling more refreshed and energetic in the morning. Now, one puzzling aspect of hypnosis is that it does seem to affect some people more than others. Some people are more easily hypnotizable than other people are. And scientists aren't completely sure why this is the case, but there are some studies that show that it might have to do with brain structures. In one study, brain scans were done on people who were easily hypnotized and were able to avoid pain while in a hypnotic state, and they found that there were significant differences in the rostrum of the brain. The rostrum is a nerve tract that aids in communication between different parts of the brain. Highly hypnotizable subjects had rostrums at an average of 31.8% larger than those who are hard to hypnotize. Another study linked high hypnotizability to connections between the executive control region of the brain and the brain's salience network. In other words, people who are better equipped to sort of filter out the noise when they make a decision were easier to hypnotize. Hypnosis has also been effective in treating chronic pain. One meta-analysis found substantial relief in 75% of patients using hypnosis as an analgesic, and the American Psychology Association lists several conditions that have been treated hypnotically with positive results. Some surgeries, including appendectomies and tumor incisions, have been done with only using hypnosis as a form of pain relief. Some childbirth has been done with hypnosis, and hypnosis has been used to treat the pain of burns. You know, as I said in a recent video on the placebo effect, pain is actually felt and experienced and perceived in the brain. So if you can alter how your brain perceives that pain, you can change that pain. Now, as I mentioned before, hypnosis is not without controversy. In 1985, the Journal of the American Medical Association issued a warning about using hypnosis to recover repressed memories, saying, quote, "Recollections obtained during hypnosis can involve confabulations and pseudo-memories." They did this because at the time there was a little bit of a rash of people being convicted of child abuse and sexual abuse because of repressed memories that were brought up later on in that child's life. In fact, one study found that only 37% of cases where people had repressed childhood memories of abuse had any kind of corroborating evidence whatsoever. And this means a lot of innocent people were accused and sometimes convicted of crimes that they didn't commit. And legality aside, I mean, just imagine how terrible that would be if your son or daughter grew up and had this diehard belief from a hypnotherapist that you had abused them as a child when you know you didn't. That just sounds horrible for everybody involved. Now, this doesn't mean that all repressed memories are false. I've talked about this in a previous video, but many therapists now don't use hypnosis as a way of finding repressed memories because of this controversy around it. Now, one last thing I think is interesting about hypnosis is that it's kind of been a part of religious rituals for thousands of years. Shamans and mystics using fasting and meditation and ritual dancing to achieve the effect. The whirling dervishes of Turkey whirl to put themselves in a trance to get closer to God. Crow Indians used to pierce their chests with bone and tie themselves to a pole, then dance around that pole till they reached an altered state. For the record, if I am given the choice of piercing my chest or spinning, I think I'll choose spinning. Altered states of mind, placebo effect, hypnosis, these are all different ways that the mind makes the impossible possible. Now, the skeptical view is that there is no real such thing as hypnosis. It's all the power of suggestion. It's all, you know, groupthink. If somebody tells you that your eyelids are heavy, you're more likely going to feel like your eyelids are actually heavy if you're in front of an audience. This is pretty much what James Braid thought in the early 1840s. He went up on that stage to debunk LaFontaine and prove that his claims were false, and he wound up pursuing a new course of study for the rest of his life. Something happened on that stage in Manchester so many years ago, something that James Braid couldn't explain. And in many ways, we still can't. But you tell me, have you ever been treated with hypnotherapy? Has it been helpful in any way? Do you think it's all a bunch of BS? Let's talk about it down in the comments below. I find it ironic that the biggest mystery of the human mind is the human mind itself. But there are a lot of things your brain can figure out, and if you want to superpower that figure-out ability, you should check out Brilliant.org. Brilliant is a website and app that's designed to help you learn how to learn, using problem-solving techniques to walk you through puzzles and games that teach you fundamental principles that you can apply to other areas of your life. Brilliant has over 60 different courses in all kinds of subjects like math, physics, and some awesome new courses in computer science. Does it ever bother you that the world is run by computers and you have no idea how they work? Brilliant's computer science courses take you from the fundamental basics of computational thinking all the way through super advanced stuff like neural networks and quantum computing, and it's all done in fun interactive games and puzzles so that if you want to just have a basic understanding, you can do that, or you can master the next steps in computer technology. How far you go is up to you. And you can sign up for free at brilliant.org/answerswithjoe and get free access to their weekly brain teasers and puzzles. And if you want to sign up for the premium subscription, the first 200 people that do that will get 20% off your subscription for life. I've been talking about Brilliant for a long time, and they just keep getting better, so definitely check it out if you haven't yet. Brilliant.org/answerswithjoe, link is down in the description. Big thanks to Brilliant for supporting this video, and a huge shout out to the Answer Files on Patreon that are helping me build a team, form an awesome community. They are cool people. There's some new people that I want to shout out real quick. Let me murder their names. They are Stephen Glasser, Warren A. Christie, Per Morganson, I think, Hunter Arnell, Reagan O'Neill, Alex Alexander, Jewel G., Ender Delfke, Ken Piper, Mark Hartley, Vishwanit Singh, Joe Court, Amy Alberts, Mark E. DuPont, Maddie Perrin, Todd Corson, Stu, Chad Oman, Jason Weir, Susan Rosegale, and Mark. I can pronounce Mark. Thank you guys so much. If you would like to join them and get early access to videos and join an awesome community, you can go to patreon.com/answerswithjoe. T-shirts available at the store. I gotta kind of lift this one up a little bit, it's lower down. Answerswithjoe.com/store. There's also hoodies, mugs, posters, stickers, what else? All kinds of fun stuff. Really cool designs from a guy in Prague who does really awesome work and it supports this channel. It's answerswithjoe.com/store. You can go check it out. Please like and share this video if you liked it. And if this is your first time here, maybe check this one out. Google thinks you might like that one. There's all these others over here on the side that might have my face on it. Please go watch those. And if you like them and you want to see more, I invite you to subscribe. I come back with videos every Monday and every Thursday. All right, thanks again for watching. You guys go out, have an eye-opening week, and I'll see you on Monday. Love you guys. Take care.